So we're going to start. Well, welcome everybody to this new session of the Senior Seminar course. Today we are pleased to have with us Dr. Norberto Nigro. Norberto is a mechanical engineer graduated from Universidad Tecnológica Nacional de Buenos Aires. And after 3 years in industrial activities in companies such as Asinda, Sebel, and Sade, and also a brief stay at the Comisión Nacional de Investigadores Espaciales, he decided to move to the scientific world, and he did his PhD under the supervision of Sergio Edelson in stuff related to FEM solutions for CFD problems. His main research, his main applications are oriented to energy management and internal combustion engines, industrial related to oil and gas, renewable energy, green energy, hydrodynamic and aerodynamic problems, and environmental problems. Today, Norberto is going to talk us about how to generate solutions to technology and industry inspired by scientific use of computational mechanics. Norberto.
Thank you very much, Ignacy. Thank you very much, all the community of CIDE for inviting me to give this seminar. And I've been very well here in Barcelona. Today we are talking about how to put the scientific approach in the technology for the industry. Pointed out that the industry needed for understanding what was my orientation in my career. I want to talk about something that at that time I saw in the difference between developed countries and developed countries like in which I grew. In developed countries, normally the public fund is dedicated only for risk innovation with enough funds. The science and technology output in hand of private, the private company are very interested in the science and technology, and the private R&D company has its own R&D in their companies to improve those outputs, and there are a very very strict policy of IP of patents, no, in innovations, and in terms of human resources, their work at the high level with high demands. On the other hand, in our countries, like Argentina, maybe Brazil, maybe outside, but I don't know. Most private companies are foreign and with R&D department in their headquarters. And rest of the are small. Rest of the company are very small with no R&D. Or large public companies buying technology abroad, public for risky innovation, but without enough funds, and the human resources working for non-challenge issues, thinking of emigrating abroad. So the landscape of our country at that time was very, very bad in that term. So I saw that the problem, probably the problem should be try to collaborate between public and private in more in conjunction, and I thought that the solution was working at the public company like CONICET, for example, as an R&D department as a third party, yeah, for that for the private. Trying to get the private sector finances in order to finance our research and probably value the work for our scientists and engineers. This is a map of Argentina. Argentina is so-called a rich country in terms of a lot of water, a lot of minerals. For example, at the northwest part of the country, oil and gas at the south part in Patagonia. Agriculture, livestock in the central part of the country, metallurgy in the east part, process industry in the central part, nuclear plants. So there are a lot of basic materials, but we have not grow in terms of manufacturing, no? So the manufactured products is not so, and the value added to our products is very, very low, no? So we have to strengthen and try to get opportunities, to get these opportunities. With this panorama, I try to put my focus on different activities for my research. I put the focus on energy demands, in industrial process demands, and environmental care, trying to get more close to the industry, and probably in the future we add some in food engineering and also in biotech engineer. Where I come from, in terms of a scientific career, I got my PhD with Sergio in 1993, doing my PhD in CFD with FEM, using stabilization scheme for advection diffusion reaction, navistoking compressible or compressible navistoke, preconditioners, absorbent boundary condition, also with Mario Storti, that is there. And in 1994 and 1995, I passed 2 years at Minnesota Supercomputer Institute, but under the guidance of Typhoon, solving CFD in rotary wing aerodynamic for helicopters using Cray YMP parallel computation. At that time was the era of supercomputing, so I become more familiar with such a technique that changed the CFD for the future. Also, I was inspired in Professor John Abraham for my ICE internal combustion engine simulations. He taught me in his courses a lot of how to simulate internal combustion engine, and also Dan Joseph, who inspired me in multi-phase flow, was one of my fields in the future. This slide shows how is our challenge. Internal combustion engine is, for me, one of the machines that has a lot of complexity. So if you try to solve all these kind of problem, probably you are in kind of solving a lot of problems to the industry. So compressible flow, multi-species, multi-phase, turbulent, reactive with combustion, moving parts, piston and valves, or parallel platforms, solving parallel platforms. So there are a lot of the different challenges. And also we developed during the 20 years or more, this kind of topics. For example, I want to talk about about each of them, but always application to problems of the industry, application to real engines. For example, in this case, the two engines that was patented in Argentina, one in Uruguay, the other, and we work with real engine for different firms. We develop our engine simulators in 0D and 1D dimensions. This is a product that is usable and visible and free and open source in the web, called ISESIM. And we use them for getting the first approach to internal combustion engine. And this is how we look the our graphic user interface for preprocessors. The post-processing is like this. You can take different pictures of different engine tests as usual, torque, power, indicated cycles. And we use also for the thesis of Damian Ramajo with a Fiat Torque 1.6 engine, and using this simulator for boundary conditions for the CFD simulation. And Damian work on the influence of the tumble in 16 valves engines. Also, this simulator was used by Ezequiel López in 2009 in his thesis for coupling in two-way coupling with a CFD at that time with Ketsifel, that was our software. And this is the contribution also using this kind of simulators. Then in 2008, we changed for using another software. You start to use OpenFOAM, and we start to develop a library of internal combustion engine that has a compressible flow inside with such a key for trying to resolve also transonic condition with the exhaust valve open or incompressible flow when the some stages of the flow is low speed with variable domains. So we include ALE formulation. We have injection also in Eulerian and in Lagrangian way, and also include the combustion recipe. This is one of the main problematic of variable domains. When you have variable domain, you have two big problems. One of these is a great volume deformation that you have. You have, for example, at this part, you have a volume, very large volume, a very small volume in two steps of the edge. You have to get the mesh for those steps. So it's a very challenging problem. But the other problem is that the connectivity is variable. You have, for example, here, you have this connection between the manifolds, intake and exhaust with the cylinder. And here you have partially connected and fully connected. So you have to manage the connectivity, the variable connectivity. Variable connectivity means that you may have no connection, volumetric interface connection, or superficial interface connection. This is one, the superficial interface connection, this is one what we are working. We try to get a contribution in trying to put emphasis on the computational efficiency and accuracy and stability. Accuracy and stability in terms of one property that is very, very important for this is conservativeness. And in terms of conservativeness, we published this article where we put evidence about how to demonstrate the conservativeness in non-conformal interfaces with different parts of the mesh, no? When, for example, the cylinder and the manifold is in front. So, and how to do this efficiently, because we inspired in an old idea, super mesh, but we call pseudo super mesh because we don't use a modified mesh. We use a super mesh with a one-to-one connectivity, but with virtual faces, not real faces. The mesh is not changed, so the cost is reduced. And we check this approach with a vortex transport in a domain that is divided into half, one half with a mesh and the other with a different mesh, the non-conformal interface here, and we saw second order accuracy conversions. This approach was implemented in an OpenFOAM distribution. So they recognized the quality of this work, and they put in the distribution in the latest distribution. So the super mesh is there. It's our contribution. We are not only user, we are also developer for OpenFOAM. In terms of the other problem, the large deformation in engines, you have to manage these two different points. The volume is very large, and when the volume is very small, so you have to be in order to resolve that problematic. We use layering for doing that. Layering is a technique that needs a 2.5 mesh type domain This is where you add and remove layers in order to get the quality of the mesh and altitude, and only change the front of the advancing front of the layering, where the change of the size is concentrated in that place. But the mesh, the rest of the mesh, the quality is kept. And also for expanding and for compressing, you have intermediate configuration where you have to guarantee the conservativeness of the variables. We, in order to remedy the problem of the concentration of the in the advancing front that has a change of cell size with a step cell size gradient there, we include also deformation. We add deformation and we combine layering with deformation in order to make the mesh more more regular in terms of gradient of size cell size. There is a simulation, and we have to make a strategy for deforming, where you need a smooth changes in the size. So you need to tune the velocity of the nodes. This is a slide that shows the parallel implementation. We develop an in-house partitioner ad hoc for these kind of problems with on a non-smooth linear speedup. And here we have an application of this library to the engine that I referred previously, the opposed piston engine. What is one of the engine patented by the Uruguay people called José Luis Alonso, and this was part of the thesis of Horacio Aguirre. And we analyze three different head pistons design. One is flat, the other is bowl, and the other is semi-filled. And we recognize which is the better. Here you have the matrix at the left, the matrix of different ignition time, because we also study the sensitivity with the ignition time of the injection, and at the right part the three different models. So the conclusions was that piston cavity one accumulates fuel at cylinder wall, piston cavity two the opposite, concentrate fuel vapor near the ignition point, and piston cavity three show the best working always compromise. And later injections have lower penetration lengths, so early injections generate better condition for the airfield mixing. So we add some this new characteristic to the patent that the Uruguay people, Uruguayan people had. And in terms of four-stroke engine, because the previous was a two-stroke engine, two-stroke in the sense of you have no valves, here you have valves, we add our library, the super mesh approach for four strokes, and also we add a new model for the attach-detach part of the event. When the valves close or open, the connectivity is changed, so you have to solve the mesh in between, so between the seat and the valve. We adopt a strategy, we model that, we adopt the strategy of leaving a gap between the seat and the valve, a gap that is mesh, no? And the gap is frozen when the valve is trying to close. And we model the rest of the closing part with a model that takes into account the effective area being done for the camshaft mechanism. This is why here you have a standard attach-detach in open foam. You have this anomaly and this anomaly. For example, this is experimental. In red, there is attach-detach standard in black, And you have a very sudden, very sudden pressure step here or here, where it's an anomalous portion of the cycle when we lose our strategy. The adjustment is much better. And we add a combustion. We use a flame-led model is a model that assume that the flame front is very thin and all the reactions is there, and we use for the wrinkling part of the flame front an equation for the density, the surface density sigma, which has a production and destruction term, production that is proportional to the density, to the kinetic turbulent kinetic energy, to the laminar flame speed, to the sigma itself, to the combustion progress variable, and the length, and two coefficients that needs calibration. And in the literature, the coefficients are constant, but we found that it's not so good. We, when you solve that equation and you solve the combustion progression B variable, you can see where the combustion is taken is producing or is active, and you can activate the mass transfer and the heat release in the energy equation. This is how our solvers looks like. We change the original version spray foam, the original version of open foam, for a solver based in species, because we in the future we want to add different species for the fuel and for the fuel composition, and also for the reactants and oxidant composition. So in this project, we work with toluene, isotan and toluene, And this is the unburned gas, they are fresh. This is the residual gases coming from the previous cycle, and this is the part of the burnt gases. Here is the flame front. You have to separate the fresh gases from the products, but fresh gases should be identified in terms of which is active or which produce energy, that is the fuel, and which not produce energy, that is the residual gases. So you can manage all in the solver. And after that, we add the calibration of the alpha, sigma, and beta, sigma in terms of experimental data coming from a real test from the experiments. This is a video, I don't know if it works, here works, where you can view the injection. And there is the injection is dual, it's double, it's two injection points, it's not one injection point. This is the another, and also we have the finally the combustion. Yeah, and here is another look, lateral view of this, but this is it's more or less the same. So and we validate with experimental data from the real bench test engine. This is the indicating cycle, experimental simulation. And we have some good agreement in the part of the combustion that is our goal at the moment. And this is how correlate with the work done by the piston. And this is a lot of different experiments with different fuels, with different operation condition of the engine. So we finish our work with this. And we change for injection, Now I'm going to show you some pictures about injection. This is a picture where we try to recognize the experimental and isolated injector and experimentally, and the same numerically with particles with the method that I call DPM or LPP. And this is another approach. This is an Eulerian approach of the, sorry, is this a Lagrangian also? No, it's Lagrangian also, but not in isolated way in an engine that is in the manifold, the intake manifold called PFI. Atomization is the subject. Atomization is a subject that has two main processes. One is the primary atomization, where first instability at the surface of the jet appears. Instability is called Kelvin-Helmholtz, and after that, with the ratio of density, appears another perturbation that is called Rayleigh Taylor, that is more or less this one. No, it's this ligaments. This wave is Kelvin Helmholtz, the rest is Rayleigh Taylor. So both mechanisms are included in all the Lagrangian codes, DPM or LPP, that most of the community use, but with empirical results obtained with a very very stretch conditions. No, and here we with this work, with the thesis of Cesar Paidetti, we try to put a focus on the physical point of view first, and after that, trying to move the understanding of the physical, trying to modify the models in LPP in order, or DPM, in order to put in the engine, but with this enhancement. We at present we are only finishing the first understanding of the physical point of view. In that sense, we have to move to another software, because OpenFOAM has not a solver that can capture the interface in a precise way. You need something like both PELIC at the surface. PELIC is piecewise linear interface compression technique that is a very precise way of doing that. We changed for Basidisk, a software of the Institute of D'Alembert, Paris 6, Professor Stéphane Popinet is his developer, and we make the thesis of Cesar Paidetti in supervision with in collaboration with Professor Stéphane Zaleski. And we use that solver that has all these features, no? Property discontinuity, interface force, multi-sig phenomena, inertial effects, turbulent flow, solved by, with these numerical tools. Both PELIC, height functions for the curvature, adaptive refinement, conservative advection. Advection is very particular. It's a geometric advection, it's not an algebraic advection. And with LES for the turbulent flow, this is how look in the most mainly the solver is a typical Aristotle equation with the surface tension terms with incompressibility restriction, and we have the mixing of the properties according to each phase with sums with these assumptions. Here we have some slide in order to recognize that we are interested in viewing such a look, no? Look the structure that is formed, and the way in which this structure form correlate with the dimensionless number, Weber number, Onesorge number, Reynolds number, in order to understand which condition is necessary to produce the breakup of the of the chest in ligaments, from ligaments to Pinchot, via Pinchot to droplets, and the also the oscillation of the droplets. Well, this is a very complex problem. And we validate also with distribution of sizes. No, this is our target, and we can do that now. This is one of our experiments. We use pulsatile inlet boundary condition in order to make the excitation necessary to produce the Kelvin Helmholtz perturbation, and also becomes all the spray. We pickle the spray in order to see what is inside, because experimentally is not possible. And in this picture we have in two cuts. The vertical cut is the curvature related with the mesh, so we can understand where the mesh is enough or where it's not. And this is the horizontal cut, where we can put the emphasis on the adaptive refinement part of this wavelet of the velocity. This is a distribution, but dynamically, not only the distribution of the size in counts, also in time. You have a different situation in time. Here you have it's very little. So here is better. Yeah, this one is better to see. This is an old picture about this, but it's representative of what we are trying to do. And we pickle the spray in order to see inside. To see inside. And here is a lot of statistics of the distribution at different positions far from the nozzle, the injector nozzle, and the same in a cumulative way. And this is a very interesting picture, because you can picture the Weber and the Reynolds and look for where or which the part of the distribution that is not well resolved. Also in terms of the velocity and the diameter. This is a mesh convergence for the problem. You refine the mesh, and it's impossible to get a real convergence. It's like in turbulence, you have refine up to a scale that is very, very, very fine enough. No, and we use a mesh of microns, of dot 4 microns, 0.4 microns. That is very, very fine mesh, but with more or less 1 week or 2 weeks simulation with 100, of course. So it's a very demanding. And finally, the pre-anatomization looks in terms of the sphericity of the structures. You can also make a distribution of the sphericity. This is a ligament that has an sphericity lower than the droplet, the spherical droplet. And also when it ruptures, here is spurious breakup, because the mesh is not enough. We published this resolution, research in this article. And here is another topic that is secondary atomization. We change the diameter of the droplet, the velocity of the free stream, and we can take the Reynolds, the Weber, the breakup time in order to have a basis for correlated with experimental that exist or are available in the literature. And these are part of the same event. You start with a spherical bubble. After that change for the bug mode. After that rupture, breakup in ligaments, and become a lot of droplets of different sizes. Here is a cut where you can view the curvature, the profile of the cut and the different instant or times of the process. And here is with the same velocity at the inlet with the different size of the bubble of the droplet. Sorry, you can recover the same spherical form if the droplet is very very small, or if bigger, you can change for the bug mode or more or another type of breakdown. And here is a map with Reynolds and Weber, and you can put the different simulations with different mode and compare with the experiments. In summary, the curvature at the interface at the break lies inside the mesh resolution limit. This is a better problem. It's better than the primary atomization because it's not so demanding. And the aerobic cap occurs at Weber relatively high compared to what was reported in laboratory than for higher density radius. So we can add more information to the lab available now in order to enhance the Lagrangian DPM models. This is our idea. The deformation of the drop is not represented in the Lagrangian DPM and is essential to determine the presence of regap. So this is our idea, our contribution. And aerobreakup simulation has a computational cost of around 5,000 CPU hours per case, so it's not so time demanding like the primary atomization, and allows a comprehensive characterization of secondary spray and a direct comparison with Lagrangian prediction. The idea we have is also to take from primary atomization structures relevant structure that make inject in this type of aerobreakup experiment in order to characterize and try to in the future use with DNS for primary atomization and a DPM or LPP for secondary atomization in a coupled way. This is well. Meanwhile, we are not. We are not the work done with the previous the work finished with the previous point of view, the physical point of view. So we have to continue working with what we have at hand, and in this sense we calibrate our DPM models based on experiments. This is an experiment done in collaboration with the University of Melbourne, Australia, with two types of injectors. And this is the experimental and this is the numerical, with the penetration of the liquid phase in red, the experimental, in shadows, the numerical. So we have a very good calibration, very good adjustment. Also, we have done the same for a benchmark spray, like Spray G, that is available in the Engine Combustion Network, ECN. And here we have three different conditions of the combustion chamber. You have a low density, medium density, and high density of the gas present in the combustion chamber in order to show the penetration, the length penetration, the angle of the cone. And finally we take advantage of this experience to put our knowledge in a project with a very young company of our technology park called Acronex. Acronex is a company that sells sells telemetry for different agricultural applications. Telemetry in the sense that, for example, here in agrochemical spraying, they put a mathematical model inside a neck of the machine, a computer in the machine, in the spray machine, and this mathematical model tells the driver of the machine if he applies the product in an effective way or if has more drift, no, of the product. So with this kind of monitor or alert, the driver of the machine can change the mode in which it operates. And we, our contribution in this project was trying to evaluate the mathematical model that the company has called Unimap, the product that they have, and after the evaluation, propose some improvements. So we propose one or two improvements to that product, because the product is very good, but one of the main thing that the product was not good was in the prediction of the distribution of the velocity at the outlet of the nozzle of the injector. No, they have a normally the T-shirt, that is the film that sells this kind of injector, tells you 3 points, D10, D50, D90, that is distribution at 3 points, at 10% of the volume, 50% of the volume, 90% of the volume. And we can, with that information, with such information, you have to go on. And this is not enough, because the distribution of the velocity is very heterogeneous. So, and we can have that information, because we solved for the internal flow with OpenFOAM, with the close to the injector but external with Basilix, and the rest with the DPM solver that we develop, that take into account the evaporation also of the product, no? Because the evaporation is a very important thing, especially in hot summer times. And we work with that in such a well. Here, I move very very quick, because we have a lot of experience in external aerodynamics. But I want to show. One thing that is important to say is for external aerodynamics, we improve a lot in terms of automation. Automation in the sense that we normally we solve in order of 1,000 simulation per year with of this 1,000 per year, more or less 2 or 3 per day. So say this is the automation degree that we reach with this approach. So we have the mesh generation and the model preparation and the solver and the post processing all in the chain, in automatic chain. This is thanks to Juan Jimenez and Horacio Guerre. This is a post processing part of the study, and we also add the dynamic part of the vehicle. No, we add the dynamic, the VIV or vortex induced vibration for tuning the suspension of the car. So in order to copy the pavement, because competition is very important to lose the adherence with the pavement. So it is very important to this. All this information is reduced, is synthesized in an aero map. This is aero map, it's a surface, a response surface. Where you have the height at the rear axis and the front axis, and you have with different attitude of the vehicle, you have the aerodynamic response synthesized, and you can add or input this information in a lap time simulator in order to tune the vehicle for each race. But this is for me important, because we add with help to develop this tricycle. It's electric tricycle. This is recently, this information is a Canadian project that one firm of Cordoba, FDC, take for the construction, for the building of the tricycle called Spiritus. You can Google this, And we did the all the aerodynamic simulation of this tricycle, because this tricycle has a 100 horsepower and 100 and a half kilometers per hour. No? It's a very high speed tricycle. And we make a lot of simulation, a lot of pictures, nice pictures. And here, you have some videos about different different ways in which the wind is inciding. And here is a very nice picture of this vehicle, but we are now trying to contribute to the development of such a more electric mobility that is very important because of the of all the climate change that we are trying to attend. And these are another well, for you finish, another applications. We apply all the previous knowledge, all the previous development in different problems. For example, in the restyling of an old engine for the bonus film, in the design of the dry sump for a DTM car on the Honda, and also for the bump stop of a shock absorber for the Hyundai Radical, all with this FDC, the same that developed the Spiritus, they construct the Spiritus tricycle. And there is some details about the model. It's very complex, all the geometry, the gap are microns, 10, 15 microns. So very difficult to mesh. So you have to use moving mesh and all the stuff that we developed for engines. Here is for the DTM Honda. The target is always have a oil in the part where the pump takes the fluid, no? And and we also contribute to energy management of a hybrid electric vehicle. This is not CFD, this is not computational mechanics, it's dynamic programming, more or less, but we have a energy plant with some mechanism, the brakes, transmission, whatever, and we put in our program, and we take the more efficient way of energy management. So we apply this to this company of Bus in Rosario, and also we contribute to this cargo vehicle, utility cargo vehicle, that is now, we are now involved in the construction of the prototype, where we include also not only mechanical parts, also the electronic, also the electrical part and the control. So we collaborate with groups of Universidad Nacional de Río Cuarto, el grupo de electrónica aplicada, and Universidad Nacional de Rosario, laboratorio de transición y control. And only for finishing my presentation, I would like to show some activities in terms of granular flow, in terms of multiphase flow, multiphase in this case granular, and we develop a two-phase two-fluid model with kinetic theory granular flow, and we also apply this to 2D fluidized bed. We compare with ANSYS, we compare with MFX, that are software more used in these simulations, and also we apply to the development of fertilizer mixer and the rotating drum mixer, and we simulate flat bottom silo discharge. And now we are working on non-local rheology model. This is on the publications. We have this model. This is a very simple model. The difference is in how we treat the convective term in a conservative formulation, non-conservative formulation, or phase-intensive formulation proposed by Oliveira and Lisa. And we found that conservative formulation is a more robust formulation because we can manage also situations with step gradients. Here we have a bubble that is growing, and we simulate the growth of the bubble with different meshes. And here we solve the Rayleigh-Taylor experiment. And here we solve for pseudo 2D fluidized bed. With different models for the frictional forces and also for the drag model. And we found these two the more influenced in this kind of models. I recommend the lecture of the first paper when I put all the hints that you need to solve this problem. Here is the comparison with Fluen, here the comparison with MFX. And finally, we participate in the construction of this machine with the firm with the company of Rafaela Condesa, and here is me inside the machine trying to elevate different parts, selecting parts, and here is the machine that is being constructed. It's a simulation of the different weights of charge at different times. And with the same company, we developed this experiment. It's a very known experiment. It's called rotating drum mixer. You put two different particles with different colors, and you can see how it meets and for different level of charge and also the speed rotation of speed. Speed of rotation, sorry. And for these two variables, you can have different behavior, no? From sumping, swamping, rotating, catarating, different ways of this mass of particles moves. And for these models, this one and this one, and the next, we change for the Hopp model. Hopp model is a rheological model. It's an Eulerian model. It's Navier-Stokes with a particular rheology. I want to show in detail here. It's a Navier-Stokes that is here. No, you have the equation of the phase in order to determine the, because you have particles and you have air. You have And the sigma has a viscosity. This viscosity is not the normal viscosity. It's a viscosity construct from the participation of the pressure, the strain rate, and a variable that depends on the inertial number, EI. This inertial number is dependent on two viscosities, two friction conditions, static and dynamic friction conditions, and all is included in this number. This model is called local Hopp model. Yeah, it is the reference. And we are interested because this model for silos, for discharging silos, is not good if the silo is large enough or is big. It's industrial silos. It's height is in order of several meters. See, we test this model for lab silos, for pilot plant silos. There is one here in Sydney that solved this problem, and I don't remember the name, but we follow this reference, and we found the same result that there that they that them in for not so large silos. But for large silos, this is not enough for solving the problem, and we are going to introduce the non-locality through a contribution of this professor Cambrin from MIT that proposed a fluidity variable G that is a fluidity that is non-local because it's a Laplacian here, so it's not local in behavior, so you can take into account the structure, the non-locality of the structure of the. So there is a lot of gallery of different other applications that I involve in, but for me, I don't know, but this is very, it's enough to stop here in wind turbines and industrial problems, oil and gas, for example, oil water separation, environmental care, working at wastewater in rivers or pools, ecological pools, or also fugitive emissions in companies, also for chemical degradation of paracetamol. This work was done with people of Universidad Politécnica de Cataluña. The name of them is Grails and Pérez Moya. They are from here, from Barcelona. And finally, I want to finish my presentation with this contribution to the COVID. Argentina, we developed with UBA, Universidad of Buenos Aires University, and ITEC, IPF Technology, this valve that allows the use of a mechanical ventilator for multiple patients, in this case for two patients. One mechanical ventilation for two patients. And we developed this prototype. We construct, we give to different hospitals, one in Santa Fe, Fusion, and we did tomography for understanding the mechanism of this kind of deformation, that is very large deformation, and with such a blockage of the section. So we work in this with a lot of expectation that contribute to our society. And thank you very much for my colleagues in this presentation. They work so hard for me to show you this. Thank you very much for your attention. That is very, very important. And also thank you very much for our people and our history.
Thank you very much, Norberto, for the nice presentation. It's a bit late, but maybe we can have one short question, if anybody wants to ask, or online, or here. Okay.
So you can generate a new mesh for a new car and run the simulation in a single day. So two or three simulations in a single day.
Yeah, more or less. Yeah.
What mesh are you using?
Measure is SnapX mesh. SnapX mesh, that is a measure of the Doppelform distribution. We obviously the car for doing 1,000 in a year, you kept the same car, no? With the same car, not with 1,000 car, different car. No, with the same car, prove different things. Prove different because you can change a lot of parts of the structure. The reglement allows you to change. But also the setup of the vehicle, the height of the vehicle, the inclination, all this. But because most of the time you have in drawing or getting the point cloud, no? That is or connect that get the STL basically. Get the STL a good STL for from STL go on. It's true that we can, for the same as STL, you can take one simulation in a day. It's more or less 5,000 iterations for a steady.
I was thinking to the pre-processing.
Yeah.
Any other comment, short comment or question? If there are no more questions, then we can close the session here. Thank you very much again, Alberto, for this presentation, and thank you all for attending. See you in the next session. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye.